Константин, about 1 hour and a half. Then we will have, about after coffee break, about 1 hour presentations, and I think we will finish today before lunch, before noon. We will distribute certificates and the best poster certificate as well. And so let us concentrate. We have only a half day to go, and then you are free. You can enjoy good weather. Our rain will start this afternoon, so please be prepared. Okay. And Konstantin today will give his lecture on the safety of fast reactors, general approaches, method, and also basic introduction and classification. Konstantin, please.
Thank you, Vladimir. Yes, I'm going to talk this two academic hours about safety of fast reactors, like phenomenology and modeling aspects with focus on liquid metal fast reactors, and especially sodium fast reactor. So this is a plan. I have one slide about Horizon 2020 SFR Smart project. This is ongoing European project. I will very, very quickly show you the main idea, structure, and so on, because it relates to safety. Then I have a few slides about safety approach developed by GIF for all systems. Then discuss a bit, probably with some repetitions, selected safety-related properties of sodium fast reactor and lead fast reactor. Then I will speak a little bit about characterization of initiating events. And then what I want to give you mainly in this lecture is examples. So specific, especially reactor, based on reactor data, examples relevant to validation of the codes, to understanding the phenomenology and physics. So I will show you SuperPhoenix startup, transient tests, few examples, then protected loss of flow at Phoenix. And then these two will be examples of design basis conditions. And then we will talk about design extension conditions. In the last part, I will show you a few examples, in fact, two codes used for liquid metal fast reactor analysis. In a summary, I would like to give you, as my personal opinion, a few examples of knowledge gaps in SFR safety analysis, probably to encourage some of you to go in this direction in your study. Okay, SFR SMART stands for European Sodium Fast Reactor Safety Measures, Assessments, and Research Tools. So this is proposal this is project in frame of Horizon 2020 program with budget 10 million euro, where the 5 million comes from Europe. 19 institutions, universities, industry, TSO, research, and so on. And here I try to put main parts or main directions of our work in this four-year project. Started in September last year, so we are now close to the first year of the project. So what we are going to do, we are going to use legacy experiments. Some of them I'm going to present you in order to calibrate and validate codes we are using for sodium fast reactor safety analysis. We are going to conduct new experiments, including measurements of MOX fuel properties, some experiments on sodium loop in Karlsruhe, and sodium boiling, very small test, some other experiments related to safety in Karlsruhe and in France. The core, the important part of the project is the next step in development of the concept of European sodium fast reactor of large power. Continuing work started with SuperPhoenix to European fast reactor and CPSFR, which was previous project. So we would like to assess different, we would like to propose new design features for ESFR, which includes, for example, low void effect core, corium discharge tubes, passive decay heat removal, pumps, and so on and so on. So in parallel, we will work, we work in this project on new instrumentation, on eddy current flow meter, in particular mentioned by Christian yesterday. We established new network for students working in the project in order to give them them possibility to work, make part of their work at some sodium facilities in Europe and so on. Okay, when we select and propose new design of ESFR, we would like, which is now after 1 year, we have this proposal. And the remaining 3 years, we would like to evaluate them from viewpoint of normal operation, to be sure that we did not deteriorate the isobreeding properties, and also for transient in safety events in the transient behavior is kind of comparable or better than an LWR and traditional sodium fast reactors. That's very brief overview. And then I start with safety approach developed by Generation 4 International Forum for all GF systems. So I will talk about specific goals, about safety philosophy. So the safety goals which were set by for Generation 4 system by GF listed here, so this system will excel in safety and reliability, will have very low likelihood and degree of reactor core damage, and will eliminate the need for off-site emergency response. This is a very challenging task, especially the last one, in my opinion, because how to practically eliminate the radioactivity release outside the plant, this is a big question mark. Okay, I will talk today a lot about basic safety functions, so I would like to emphasize the importance of them. So they are listed here. So at every reactor state, the basic safety functions should be fulfilled, and they are control of reactivity. So reactivity should not exceed $1, as we discussed yesterday, to avoid prompt criticality. At every moment, we should be able to control the reactivity to shut down the reactor in a passive way or in active way. So first, control of reactivity. Then removal of heat from the fuel, in particular decay heat. Again, we should have diversified, redundant systems. We should build safety architecture from these systems in order to show, to guarantee that in any event, we have the mechanism, we have the path of removing the heat from the fuel where it is generated, finally to atmosphere. So we should have a safe preserving barriers to radioactivity, the safe path to remove heat. And finally, the third is confinement of radioactive materials. Again, at every reactor state, we would like to have all our radioactivity inside the boundaries, the barriers. So we have several barriers in nuclear power plants, physical barriers, and finally, as we mentioned above, so we would like to keep the radioactivity inside the nuclear power plant. Okay, the safety philosophy, whatever it means, but we say that there is an opportunity to improve safety of Generation 4 systems, which is already very good or excellent for Generation 2 and 3 systems. So it's very politically correct formulation. The very high importance of principle of defense in depth is preserved for Generation 4 systems. I will say a few words about this principle. So the design process should be driven by so-called risk-informed approach, which in simple words means that we should use not only the deterministic method, but also probabilistic to evaluate and compare probabilities of different events. And finally, important for us also is the emphasis for us is that for Gen 4 systems, in addition to prototyping and demonstration, we are going to use more and more modeling and simulation. So it's a large role with modern computers, with modern tools. We would like to use more and more modeling and simulation to fulfill the goals and philosophy. Okay, considering safety improvement, which we mentioned, so again, we already have very good level or excellent level for existing reactors, and we keep them as a reference for Gen 4, for future reactors, and we see the possibility for further safety improvement and progress in knowledge and technologies, and which is probably more important, we would like to use our knowledge in order to apply the consistent safety philosophy early in the design process in order to build in the fundamental design, the safety in the into the design rather than add on to the system architecture later. So with, when generation 2 and 3 systems were built, so there was no some extended knowledge which we have now, and for this reason, sometimes we upgrade the design of these reactors to improve the safety. So in case of Gen 4, the approach is that let's try to think, to be smart in order to put in the design the safety measures against using our knowledge, let's say like this. Okay, defense in depth, physical barrier. So this terminology came from military, so from old times when they build the castle and make many layers of protection, as shown here. You can imagine this in order to protect. If you lose one level of defense and level of protection that we have still another one, that's roughly the idea intuitively. So it's the levels of protection is rather a concept, an idea, but there is also the physical barriers, which also you can imagine as a protection barriers between radioactive materials and the environment. And normally we distinguish either 3 or 4 barriers in nuclear power plants illustrated here. So it's fuel matrix. Sometimes it's considered as barrier. Sometimes people don't like it, but definitely it's fuel cladding, primary system boundary, and finally containment. So, as I said, there is a physical barriers, but there is levels of protections which are more conceptual, more ideas than physical things that the barrier in usual sense as a wall, although they are connected. So we distinguish 5 levels of protection. Prevent abnormal operation, control abnormal operation, prevent severe accidents, control severe accidents, and then mitigate off-site releases. There is many slightly different ways of presenting this or discussing, and IAEA is doing probably the best work in describing different levels of protection. In order to illustrate, I did this chart so to give you my own understanding. So this chart is like shows the map of all possible reactor states. So every point corresponds to some state of the reactor, of the system. And we have initiating events shown like this, and then safety measures shown like this, the failures. So here we have an area of normal operation, and it is protected by some measures illustrated by this green boundary. So when something happened, when initiating event, we have initiating event, I don't know, a small earthquake, then our barrier should kind of reflect and bounce this and bring the reactor to another normal operation state, normally safe shutdown. And in this case, safety measure can be activation of reactor scram, for example. So this is normal operation. This is big area which includes operational transients like startup or shutdown or change of power, things like this. And when we have more strong initiating event, then this barrier can fail and we bring our reactor into the abnormal state, for example, anticipated operational occurrences, one of the terminology used. And again, here we should have safety measures which brings it back to, for example, to safe shutdown against scram or any other passive systems. So, and again, here we have another barrier which defend these states from development into the higher, more problematic reactor states like design basis accidents or severe accidents. Okay, if we have a sequence of events, then we can arrive from the point of anticipated operational occurrence into the design basis accidents. So it's more like incident, and this is accident. Well, that's not very much sense, but it's classification. And also we can have event which directly brings reactor from normal operation to design basis accidents. Again, here we have some third level of defense against to prevent severe accidents. And around we have like states which correspond to design extension conditions. Sometimes part of the design extension conditions are severe accidents. We distinguish also several phases of design extension conditions like initiation and transition, expansion, and in-vessel cooling. So this we will discuss a bit later. Normally, my understanding that when we have severe accidents, then we cannot restart reactor later. It means the core is meltdown significantly. So it's not that we scram the reactor and then start again. So we should either build new one or repair significantly. That's what we call severe accidents. Okay, I think this chart gives you the general idea. So the fourth defense in depth is here. So we prevent this, the final, the fourth, prevents the release of radioactivity outside the containment. And then I didn't show here the fifth defense in depth level of protection, which limits the consequences. So we should have measures like, okay, let's remove these plants or this grass and things like this. So let's evacuate people from this area. So this is a last level of defense, a set of measures. I didn't put them here because we are planning to practically eliminate the need for these safety measures. But as I said, it's a very difficult question how to do it. Should we consider it or not? How to eliminate, how to demonstrate, how to prove? It's all open questions. Anyway, once again, I repeat, safety functions of generation 4 system is control of reactivity, removal of heat from the fuel, and confinement of radioactive materials for every reactor state, which I showed before, For example, it can be severe accident state when we have the corium in the core catcher, and we should control the reactivity, we should remove heat from corium, and we should guarantee confinement of radioactive materials. So I give you examples for these three safety functions using our European sodium fast reactor new design. So you will learn a little bit also new design. So the first one is control of reactivity. I showed you here the axial cut of the core, which I showed also on Tuesday. So the first safety measure is CRAM activation by one of the signals or just by operator, illustrated here with one. So it's just insertion of all control rods. If it doesn't work for some reason, then we have special devices on safety rod drive lines, which is based on Curie point. So when temperature, coolant temperature at the outlet of the core goes high enough, then magnetic properties of these devices disappears due to this effect, and it unlocks the connection, and by gravity, these control rods are falling down and inserted in the core. Okay, if for some reason it doesn't work, then we have another safety measures, which is use of sodium plenum and flat core, what was described yesterday by Vladimir. So we have this in every assembly, some empty space between the top of the fuel bundle and the bottom of the shielding. This is empty space inside the fuel subassembly filled with sodium. And it serves, this layer serves as neutron reflector, liquid neutron reflector in normal operation. So neutron is reflected by this sodium plenum, it goes back. But when we have increase of temperature, it reaches the boiling point, then we have the void in this region. And it's passively, we passively remove the neutron reflector, and suddenly fuel see directly the shielding, axial shielding. Axial shielding contains a lot of absorber, as any shielding. And in this way, the neutrons are not reflected anymore, they are absorbed. So we are efficiently insert absorber in a way by this measure. So this is the third measure, sodium plenum. We also should have the pancake core, which is very flat. So the big diameter and relatively short height, which allows us to increase the leakage component in normal operation, and therefore in abnormal operation, it will be high also. We will discuss it a little bit later, the components of void effect. Then if for some reason sodium plenum doesn't work and we have core meltdown, that we have another measure, which is corium discharge tubes. So it's really very empty channels, including diagrid. So in the diagrid, we also have empty space to make it easier for corium, for melted fuel and cladding and structural material to facilitate the flow in this direction in order to avoid the accumulation of fuel in some places and potential recriticality. So it's again control of reactivity when fuel is melting down. So it's similar for Japanese design, but they have this channel in inside every assembly. And we propose here to use a dedicated whole empty assemblies. Okay, if for some, then when we relocated the corium towards to the corium co-catcher shown here schematically, then our fissile is located here, and we should design the core catcher to guarantee subcriticality of corium. We should probably add some neutron absorber, things like this. Okay, five levels, five measures of different levels of protection. For the second safety function, removal of heat from the fuel, again, example of SFI. In case of reactor shutdown, we have several decay heat removal passes, systems. So the first pass, we would like to use the normal heat transfer pass to remove decay heat. So we should design this regime of cooling in order to remove heat due to probably natural circulation of primary, secondary coolant, and then remove heat by feed water through the steam generator. If it doesn't work for some reasons, then we have decay heat removal system we call DHRS2, which is removing the decay heat from the surface of steam generator, as in some of the poster of our Indian student. They are also studying this cooling of the steam generator surface by natural circulation of air. So we use a special casing to improve this, the conditions of natural circulation. And it was also used in Phoenix. I will show you later the experiment. So it's proven experimentally that this approach is working. Okay, if for some reason we lost completely the secondary system. So imagine that something happens and we don't have this anymore. It's cut, I don't know, the earthquake, whatever. Then we have a decay heat removal system one, DHRS1, which is connected in parallel, you see, to, so it's like small secondary system, which uses secondary sodium and work on natural convection with the help of thermal pump also. And here we have air sodium heat exchanger and natural convection of air assisted by the tall chimney. And finally, we have one more system, which we call DHRS3, which is located in reactor pit and used for in normal operation for cooling the concrete. So the concrete should be always below 70 degrees centigrade. And we used, in fact, two systems. One is oil and another is water under forced convection. So we always have this like auxiliary system, which we can also use to remove decay heat from the core. Okay, the third safety function is confinement of radioactive materials. And here we make optimization of confinement measures and economy. So because this, everything related to confinement is very expensive. It's vessels, it's pit, it's big structures. And our idea, we would like to modify the reactor roof to have it massive steel without a lot of porosities. So it's very heavy, it's 80 centimeters thick. There is no water inside, there is no cooling compared to Super Phoenix. And for this reason, it's hot at the bottom and it reduces sodium deposit in lower part. That's what Christian presented us yesterday. So this is one of the good consequence of this design. So it's also good radiation protection, which allows us to avoid reactor dome. So it's kind of dome above, one more physical barrier used in Super Phoenix. And here we propose to eliminate it. Because we believe that our measures is good enough to guarantee the confinement of radioactive materials. We also minimize penetrations. So we don't have dedicated decay heat removal heat exchanger. As I showed you, we connected it to intermediate loop. And in this way, the number of penetrations is minimized. So it's for pumps, it's for eye checks, but nothing more. And even more, we propose to to weld components for the operation in order to improve the confinements. So this, the rotating plugs are also solid, so no porosity inside, and with the use of eutectic freezing seal, which also guarantees a good confinement during operation. Considering reactor pit, so we have strong proposal to eliminate safety vessels. So Super Phoenix has two vessels, so reactor vessel and safety vessel. And here, our proposal is let's eliminate safety vessel and instead let's make a metallic liner on isolation surface. So I tried to shrink two parts and show everything. So it's concrete reactor pit. And here we have isolation like this. And on the surface of the isolation, we propose to put metallic liner, which is a replacement of safety vessel and which is ready to withstand the leak of reactor vessel and to have sodium here. Then we calculated that in case of the break, we have the level which is still above IHX windows, things like this. And we still have the enough gap to let robots go inside and make in-service inspection of the reactor vessel. So finally, we have a robust, strong confinement of primary system, which we hope guarantees the confinement of radioactive materials. At least we think we significantly improve the confinement and improve the economy also. So the reactor becomes cheaper. This is general approach. So we like to simplify the design. The simpler, the better, and the safer. That's our keywords. So I already mentioned this modeling and simulation is important for us, and we discuss it today is that yes, prototyping and demonstration is a must, but these are expensive and contribute to the long lead time associated with the development of new technology. But modeling and simulation can provide more and more thorough evaluations of candidate design, and we can make more, we can explore more possibilities and optimize and find good solutions. And reduce uncertainties. Okay, the next part, I would like to quickly show you some repetitions, selected safety-related properties, focusing on liquid metal fast reactor, we'll talk a bit about coolant properties. It was already a lot, but probably something new pop up. I propose some systematization. And then we will talk about main reactivity effects because this is the topic of our lecture, so safety modeling, phenomenology. Okay, I already showed this plot, the density versus temperature. I like it. I showed it for all six GIF systems. Here I have only liquid metal and PWR, or light water, for comparison. And you can see the operational margins. So what we can see from this plot, two things, well, it's more, but I would like to emphasize the margins to boiling for sodium and lead. So this is outlet coolant temperature, and we don't have on this plot the phase change. So it's all single phase. So when we heat up, when we increase the temperature, it remains single phase, and it means that all structures can thermally expand. The same situation for sodium. Well, it's not such big, but still we have something like 300, 350 degrees before boiling. And this is significant delta T, which allows the structures thermally expand. And this is extremely important for reactivity. So I would like to emphasize this and to I would like you to take it with you after this lecture. Importance of thermal expansion for liquid metal fast reactors from your point of reactivity. Okay, another point is margin to freezing. So it's not margin to boiling for LFR, for lead fast reactor, but margin to freezing is relatively small. This makes it necessary to design special safety measures for LFR against freezing. Well, for pressurized water reactor, the margin to boiling is very small, and it means thermal expansion is not important, because very quickly we have boiling and huge negative reactivity from negative void effects. That's why normally we don't care much about thermal expansion and pressurized water reactor. So density, lead has a very high density. We need powerful pumps, we need high requirements for seismic stability. Reactor vessel and support structures should have high strength to host this mass. We need special measures to eliminate blowing up of fuel assemblies due to buoyancy. What we discussed on Tuesday, the special design with some ballast and so on. It's all negative, so the color code, okay, red is negative. Yeah, green is good. Then what is good about high density is that, well, it's good and bad, I don't know. The probability of secondary critical mass formation just due to gravity is low, because fuel density and lead density is close. So fuel will flow probably up or down, but it will be distributed, and it is not collected in one place. And this reduces the probability of secondary critical mass formation. On the other hand, we don't know exactly where the fuel is, and it also has negative side. And the probability of vapor or gas entrainment in the core is low, because we have the high density. We need to have a very high pressure to inject gas and to let it go down to the core and inlet and then enter the core. Okay, it's more difficult than for sodium, which has lower density and lower buoyancy force. Chemical activity, so we distinguish between sodium and lead. Both is chemically active, okay? For sodium, it's quick chemical activity. It's reaction with air and water, which generates heat. There is danger of fire, explosion, danger of loss of coolant caused by coolant burning out. Probably it's one of the scenario, I don't know. And the complication of reactor design. So we need an intermediate circuit, we need probably special fire protection measures. So lead is also chemically active, but it slowly reacts with structural materials by dissolving and eroding them. We need special measures to protect cladding. For example, online control of oxygen concentration, discussed already. The structural materials are dissolving if not protected. And we should also remember that their removal from the core can result in positive reactivity effect. If you imagine that we still have the integral fuel bundle, but cladding is slowly dissolving, so we are removing cladding. It's becoming thinner, but fuel still in place, then it can be huge positive reactivity insertion. And coolant temperatures and velocities are limited by erosion. Okay, boiling for sodium and lead, they have high boiling points. And it means that high temperature and high efficiency provided at low primary pressure. Good, green. So we enhance reactor safety and reliability, simplify design, and facilitate fuel rod operation. Kind of neutral, high margin to boiling makes changes of the geometry due to thermal expansion very important, what we already discussed. Why neutral? Because if we are clever, we design them in a good way to insert negative reactivity, but in some cases, we can have events which insert positive reactivity. For lead, boiling point is higher than stainless steel melting point. And there is a danger of positive reactivity insertion, what we already discussed, but now due to melting of the structural material from the core. When we go too high, to 1500 degrees centigrade, then cladding can start melting and relocating, and this can be positive reactivity insertion. For sodium boiling, so danger of cladding overheating due to dryout, danger of positive reactivity insertion due to sodium boiling, discussed already, and we will discuss more, and danger of pressure shocks, so mechanical and reactivity impact, which can be caused by sodium boiling. We don't know exactly if it's true or not, but potentially when bubble of vapor is collapsing due to very fast condensation, for example, we can imagine that it will be the source of pressure waves which can impact the structure, which can shake the core like, well, not like earthquake, but somehow, and perturb the reactivity, or have mechanical impact on the integrity of the core. So freezing, I put only lead because it has relatively low margin to freezing, like 130 degrees, and there is a danger of coolant freezing during startup, repair and maintenance, shutdown transient, so it requires special measures, I would say. Ideally, electrical heaters, which are power enough to melt down the whole inventory of primary lead, which can be unacceptably expensive, of course. Then it creates what Christian mentioned, difficulties of in-service expansion, inspection, because the temperature is relatively high to keep it above freezing point. But there is also positive things. The loss of coolant after circuit break is limited because of fast coolant freezing, so it's healing of the leaks, which is not bad. And also when lead goes out and spill on the floor, then it's rapidly freezing, and it eliminates deep penetration of radioactive coolant in the environment, so it's kind of kept frozen and limited volume, so it's good. Okay, the first reactivity effect is a Doppler reactivity effect. It's an apparent broadening of the normally narrow resonance peaks due to thermal motion of nuclei. So here, I would like everybody knows what is Doppler, but be respected. It's not so simple as can be, as you can think from the first sign, because there is a combination of widening of resonances and self-shielding effect. The change of the flux shape at the resonance energy. And only a combination of these two effects has sense, because if flux doesn't change, the widening or broadening doesn't change reactivity. So if this resonance absorber is infinitely dilute, then there will be no reactivity effect. It really should self-shield. The self-shielding effect should be present. It should be enough. This absorber should present enough amount. And then the broadening will change this shape of the flux and the resonance energy and reduce self-shielding effect. This I emphasize as the physics of Doppler reactivity effect. So it's driven by fuel temperature, it's instant negative reactivity feedback, and it's basis of safety both all reactors, okay, which has resonance absorber. So, okay, fuel temperature goes up. Normally, uranium-238, which we have a lot in reactor, resonance is broadening, and capture rate increasing, and reactivity goes down. We know from experiment the dependence of delta rho on the temperature, and in fast spectrum, we normally use logarithmic dependence and the Doppler constant, which is not always constant, in fact, can depend on temperature, but it's approximation. And in thermal spectrum, traditionally, we use linear approximation. And It was took me some time, some years to understand why it is different, because the physics of the phenomena is the same, but then someone gave me good advice that the reason of these two different formulation is that in fast spectrum system, we have just bigger delta T change. And when it's big, then we need logarithm to better describe. In thermal spectrum, delta T is small, and linear interpolation is good enough. So Doppler constant and Doppler coefficient. Different units. Doppler constant is PCM, and Doppler coefficient is PCM per degree. Okay, the last line I added is about stainless steel cladding. So don't forget that stainless steel cladding has Doppler effect, negative, but and significant. It's like 10% of fuel Doppler effect, because often we neglect it in our analysis. We should not forget it. I think it's from iron isotopes. So coolant density and void reactivity effect, the second important for liquid metal fast reactors. So it's a quick reactivity feedback that is a big challenge for safety, because it can be positive and it's not present in thermal reactor. As you know, when we remove coolant, which is moderator, in a water reactor, then we remove moderation and we insert a big negative reactivity, because practically we go from the region of very high cross sections to region of lower cross sections in general. So coolant density effect or void effect, so they are the same, but when we reduce density due to thermal expansion, we call it density effect. When we completely remove or boil off, we call it void effect. So it leads to three effects. The first is decrease of capture by coolant. It's evident. We remove some absorber, which is sodium, for example, and so we don't absorb some part of the neutron. It's positive effect, but it's small. There is the last one is hardening of spectrum. So we remove moderator. We don't call it moderator. It's slowing down, but spectrum becomes harder. It's evident. And again, if you remember the eta value in the high energy region, then it goes up for plutonium 9 quite strongly. And it means when we move spectrum to the right, to the fast region, that we make fission, make production ratio to absorption bigger. And this means positive reactivity. So when we make fast reactor faster, it means it's more positive effect. So fast reactor faster. And in thermal system, we make thermal reactor less thermal, and then the effect is negative. It's just to recall. But the good news, the hope we have, is that there is also increase of leakage. When we remove sodium, then we remove the reflector, in a way, effective reflector, and the neutrons can leak more freely. What I described to you before about sodium plenum, that's the example. So that's how we use the increase of leakage due to void effect. All these effects are strongly three-dimensional. This is a picture from Walter Reynolds from our fast reactor Bible, which shows the dependent. This is the center of the reactor. Imagine cylindrical. This is the radius. And we see the total reactivity distribution, void reactivity, then spectral hardening, which is the biggest positive component. Then the capture is very small. I don't know, it should be constant. And then the leakage. So it's bigger at the periphery and smaller, or zero at the center. So everything is strongly three-dimensional, which creates additional difficulty for modeling. Okay, positive in the center, spectral hardening dominating, and negative at co-periphery and reflector. Now I have a few slides. I go through quickly. to emphasize the importance of thermal expansion reactivity effects, which we already discussed. So this here, we talked about differential expansion of number of materials, fuel, cladding, sodium, and absorber, four materials. They can expand in a different way and change the volume fraction of these four. And I show you mechanism. Here is the terminology. This is control rod drive lines, the core, the diagrid, and the strong back. So strong back is a kind of big table which stands on the bottom of the reactor vessel. On this table, we put diagrid and insert assemblies in the diagrid. And control rod drive lines are connected to the top, to the roof of the reactor. And this is the vessel. So the fuel thermal expansion, I show you with some small cartoon how it expands, where the temperature is increasing and how it expands. So when we heat up fuel, then it expands axially, and we have more parasitic absorption by cladding. For the same fuel, we have more cladding and more sodium, and we insert control rod slightly. So this what I mentioned about change of volume fractions. So when we have more cladding, we insert absorber, it's negative. When we have more sodium, we have more scattering. It's opposite to void effect. So we increase the density efficiently, it's again negative effect. The problem here that depending on the state of the fuel clad gap, it can be either free expansion of fuel or expansion of the system fuel clad, which is more complicated for modeling. Okay, typical value. The next one is clad thermal expansion. So when we heat up the clad, it expands radially and axially. When it expands axially, then we have less parasitic absorption by cladding. For the same fuel, it's positive effect. When it expands radially, it pushes out sodium. We have less scattering by sodium. Again, positive effect. So the next is diagrid thermal expansion. So when we heat up this structure where we insert assemblies, it expands radially and it increases the distance between the centers of the assemblies. And efficiently it increases the inter-assembly gap. And again, for the same fuel, we have more sodium. It's negative effect. It's good for safety and it's quite strong. It's minus 1 PCM typical value for every degree. But it's relatively slow because we should heat up by inlet temperature. It's driven by inlet temperature. We should heat up the massive support structure. So the next one is strong back thermal expansion effect. We just distinguish between strong back and diagrid. Diagrid is radial and strong back is axial. So axial expansion, when we heat up by inlet temperature, a little bit inject core towards the control rods and insert negative reactivity. Again, big time needed. But if we manage to heat up it by 1 degree, we can insert as much as minus 2 PCM, which is a big value. So finally, the vessel. We can also heat up the vessel, and vessel expands. Normally, it fixed at the top, and it can elongate, you see, and expands down. And this withdraws the core from the control rods. Again, it's very slow. It's like several minutes is needed, but then for every degree, it can be 4 PCM positive. Very important for safety, probably number three, I would say, after Doppler and coolant density, is control rod drive line expansion effect. It's now driven by outlet temperature. When power goes down, for example, then we have hotter sodium at the outlet, and it contacts with control rod drive lines. They are expand and insert passively absorber in the core. It's delayed, but it's comparable with diagrid expansion value. So thermal expansion reactivity effects are important. I will show you at SuperPhoenix startup transient, but especially good demonstration was at EBR2, already mentioned several times, CRP we had at IAA, was to analyze this transient And we see the differential expansion of all these materials makes contribution to self-protection of EBR2 in unprotected loss of flow experiment. So you can check the tech doc on EBR2 CRP for details. Okay, the next part, I would like to briefly introduce initiating events. Okay, really quickly. So we distinguish between design basis conditions and design extension conditions. And design basis conditions we characterize with four, from DBC1 to DBC4, depending on evaluation of probability. So DBC1 is operating conditions. DBC2 is incidence. What I showed you, remember, anticipated operational occurrences, which is probability is above 10 to the minus 2, which means one during reactor life, more or less. DBC3 is below 10 to the minus 2, so it should not occur during reactor life, in fact. And the examples are cost down of all primary pumps, which we discussed a little bit. And DBC4 is a lower probability, like the failure of the pipe, connecting pipe and diagram. For design extension condition, there is also classification, like events which do not lead to whole core accident and which leads to whole core accident but not practically eliminated and practically eliminated situations. Okay, I don't go into the details. I just want to say that there is some classification, quite detailed, in fact, described in the safety regulation documents. So now I want to show you the examples. And first one is Super Phoenix startup tests, which are operational transient. They relate to design basis conditions, of course, and it's DBC1 operational transient. So Super Phoenix is large power SFA, 3,000 megawatts thermal, 16 ton per second flow rate, inlet outlet temperature classical. So the vessel 20 by 20, 3,000 tons, and so on. So MOX fuel. And what we used here, we used a published open publication. You can see here Nuclear Science and Engineering volume, which was completely devoted to startup tests. And I just take on this slide the figures which we used for this exercise. So we digitized the plots and used them for our model, for validating our model. And the task was to create a computer model of the SPX core and to find a unique set of reactivity coefficients. We did not specify, but we would like to find the best fit, which gives us a good results for all six transients which were published. Okay, it was kind of analysis of consistency of the results. And then we obtained at the end the set of reactivity coefficient and the model. So the model was very simple. We used trace here. We represented the core with just two channels, like fissile fuel, fertile fuel, two heat structure for two fuel rods, inlet, outlet. So we specified this was experimental data, flow rate and temperature versus time. The power was output, the experimental results. So we have several structures, like control rod was, drive line was here, and the rest digrid, vessel, and strongbike was connected to the inlet. We had some trick to simulate the delays, time delays with reaction to the change of inlet temperature. I don't have time to go into the details. The first test was a positive reactivity step. So it was isothermal at fixed temperature, zero power, and then control rod withdrawal inserted 30 PCM. It was like reactor startup. So we knew the reactivity insertion and we knew the inlet coolant temperature. It was increasing. So that's what we obtained. This is the power. Red is on the left, red is experimental data and black is our calculation. So the power goes up and then goes down and stabilizes at some level. And this is outlet temperature. Very good agreement that we analyzed the components of reactivity, like black is total reactivity, and it consists of the inserted reactivity. And then, of course, we have some reaction from Doppler, negative fuel expansion, and with some delay, we have digrid strong back and vessel expansion because of the change of the inlet temperature. So what is important here, we check, we validate also the response, our fuel modeling, because it is very important that we calculate fuel thermal expansion and correspondingly gap conductance during our transit. So fuel thermal conductivity, thermal expansion, and change of the gap size and change of the gap conductance allows us to predict the dynamics of fuel temperature, which gives us the dynamics of Doppler effect, which gives us good agreement at the maximum, and the dynamics is reasonably good. So the next example is the same, but reverse. It's negative reactivity step. Now it's at high power, 50% power, and in three steps, we inserted 75 PCM, three steps by 25 PCM. Shown here, and this is an inlet coolant temperature. Okay, it's kind of reversed, so the power is decreasing, and then somehow goes up and stabilizes. And again, we managed to represent with the same set of coefficients reasonably well. Now we have positive Doppler, we have positive fuel expansion, and positive vessel. Next is a change of inlet temperature, so overcooling. So basically here we check the digrid and strong back and vessel thermal expansion. Okay, it's relatively good agreement, the increase of the power. So we reduce overcooling, reduce the temperature, and so the reactor with negative feedback will try to compensate and will increase the power. So that we observe increases and then stabilization. And now we have the two big players. One is all structures expansion, which is combination of negative digrid and strong back, and with some delay, positive vessel. Okay, in case of cooling down, it's the reverse, positive from digrid and strong back, and negative from this point, negative from vessel. So this makes us, for us, very clear, and we see here in this experiment, we see vessel expansion effect. So there is no other mechanism of this behavior than vessel expansion, and it was interesting. So then the next, I don't present you all, but some significantly different was loss of flow. So it was reduction of the core flow rate as shown here, abrupt reduction, and then some function, some reduction of inlet temperature, which gives quite complicated oscillatory behavior of power. It goes up and down and up and then oscillation. And we managed to reproduce qualitatively and here the interplay between Doppler and expansion, and especially we catch this effect here, which was relatively difficult to simulate, and again, we need good fuel behavior modeling here. Okay, the next example I would like to show you relates to design basis conditions. Example still, but now to more severe, I would say, like DBC4, which we can call protected loss of flow. This was experiment at Phoenix. It was another CRP, which was finished 3 years ago or something like this. It's based on the data from Phoenix, which was smaller, medium power as far, so it was 560 megawatt thermal power, about 3 tons per second, the flow rate, inlet temperature, inlet-outlet temperatures, yeah, slightly different. And vessel height and that diameter is more or less 2 times smaller, 10 by 12 compared to Super Phoenix. The mass is 800 tons. The fuel is the same. Yes, there was at the end of Phoenix, before decommissioning, it was decided to make end-of-life tests. So it's basically every reactor, like startup tests at the beginning, end-of-life test at the end. So, and there was a program. Here you can check this paper and probably other papers, which describes the whole set of tests. And I listed what I know. I think it's complete, but I'm not sure. So one of the thermohydraulic transient was natural convection. And the data for this transient was kindly made open to IAEA, to CRP by CEA, and we use this data. Okay, this graph shows the sequence of events. So at the first phase, the only thing which was done was feed water shutdown, and it was for 7 minutes. And it was, in fact, not loss of flow because pumps were operating, but it was unprotected loss of heat sink. It's very, very interesting part. I think I don't speak about this, but it allows us to calculate the neutronics. But then after 7 minutes of this unprotected transient, the power goes down by 60%. Then there was scram. So reactor was scrammed, and we have after this decay heat removal, and this phase was for 2 hours. So the reactor was scrammed, and the pumps, primary pumps were stopped. So now it is protected loss of flow, and the goal was to see the transition from forced convection to natural convection. Remember that there is no feed water, so it's also dry out of the steam generators, and there is no heat sink. And it was for 3 hours. Okay. The second phase for 3 hours. And the third phase was opening of steam generator casing. I told you that we have similar safety measure in ESFR. So the steam generator is put into the casing. And if we open the windows at inlet and outlet, then atmospheric air starts to circulate by natural convection, and it removes the heat. And so the goal of this experiment was to not only to look at the transition from forced to natural convection, but also to check if this system is efficient enough to remove the decay heat. And this third phase was for another 4 hours. Okay, this, I have only one slide, I think. Yeah, another slide. But this slide shows in logarithmic scale the three phases. The beginning, so before the scram, okay, we have reactor flow rate and power. So the flow rate is blue, calculated, and power is red. And in reference benchmark, the power was specified. But you can see this reduction. So this reduction was unprotected, no scram. It was reactivity feedbacks. And it was strong. I will show on the next slide. And then here on the second graph, we have primary coolant temperature like at different points. Core outlet, I checks. Outlet, core inlet, pump inlet, and so on, which is calculated, and the same values experiment. Okay, so what we can see here, in this calculation, we specified reactor power, We calculated flow rate because it was not measured. And we can see good agreement in the first phase, unprotected phase, constant flow rate. There is no pump trips. I would say, well, there is some stratification here. But in general, I would say reasonably good agreement. And if you look at the phase three, which is asymptotic, we also can say that we have quite good agreement with the rate of cooling down. And the really the problem, in my opinion, is here in the transition from forced convection to to established natural convection. This is the transition. And here we have problems. Because in our calculation, we used one-dimensional model, which is not good. So we need, we should work in this direction. And there is a lot of activities at CEA and other institutions to apply CFD or porous medium models, three-dimensional models, to catch these three-dimensional effects. OK, this slide shows the first 7 minutes of the test, which were unprotected loss of heat sink. You can see the decomposition, what we predicted for reactivity. Reactivity was measured. And you can see with the dots, it's or circles, it's measurement, and solid line is calculations. And this is the power, also measurements and calculations. So the power go down, you can see by 60%. It demonstrated the safety, self-protection of the reactor, but also we managed to identify the important components like digrid expansion, of course, strong, but also positive Doppler. Positive Doppler is always a problem in oxide fuel, which does not exist, I would say, in metallic fuel, which is cold fuel, very close to coolant temperature, and we don't have margin for positive boiling in metallic fuel. But in general, we can say that we can emphasize the importance of accurate prediction of core inlet temperature, fuel clad gap conductance, and fuel expansion mechanisms. Okay, for design extension conditions, I have a few slides which is very similar to what Vladimir presented, similar analysis of sodium boiling in unprotected loss of flow in Astrid. And here we did similar analysis. Okay, I don't say Astrid, I say low void core, but Astrid-like, let's say like this. So this shows the position of sodium plenum. This is a subassembly, this is fuel, sodium plenum, and shielding. And the colors shows different points which you can see here on the plots. So this is power. Power goes down due to coolant density effects and positive field Doppler negative expansions. But at this point, the sodium starts boiling. And we observe the abrupt reduction of power and then smooth reduction with small oscillations. So we had here very detailed model. We simulated separately every assembly, and we observed that the frequency and the amplitude of this oscillation strongly depends on the nodalization. So that's why I recommend you to make, in such cases, as detailed model as possible, because it's not independent. Then the reactivity feedbacks. We have positive Doppler, as I already mentioned, and negative coolant density or void effect. Because of voiding the sodium plenum, as I already discussed, and its reflector is not here anymore, and neutrons are absorbed in the shielding. So strong negative effect. And here, we decompose this effect. This blue is decomposed here. It consists of strong negative sodium plenum effect and slightly positive effect from fuel region. So we showed that in this case of sodium boiling, the boiling front does not propagate down. It's limited somewhere here. We have boiling front here. But what is interesting also, this cyclic boiling regime, which we call chugging, or there is this regime in water conditions called chugging. So it's oscillations of void like this. So the bubble is formed, and then it leaves the channel, and cold sodium entering, it makes remaining gas condensing, and we have very violent condensation, very fast, which also generate pressure pulses shown here. No, it's vapor generation rate, and this is pressure pulses. And it's huge. It, in this case, it's like 3 megapascals. It's very big. But we don't know if it's physical or not. So we have reactivity effect. We have thermohydraulic effect, like chugging boiling regime. And we have mechanical effect, which is formation and propagation of pressure waves. So important, as Vladimir also emphasized, that there is no permanent dryout and there is no clad melting. So this is clad temperature and there is no fuel melting. Fuel is cooling down. Good news. If we manage to show that it's really the existing effect, existing protection, it's new level of protection. And if you manage to demonstrate that this design of the core provides this self-protection, it will be, in my opinion, breakthrough in safety demonstration of sodium fast reactor. Okay, we need experiment, and we decided to start in this FastSmart project steam water experiment. We built in Lausanne at the PFL. So we have acrylic glass with subcooled water, and we inject from steam generator some 5 bar pressure steam. And we started to look at this. Now we have high-speed fast camera, and we would like to look at the condensation regimes and when we have chugging and so on. So we are at the beginning, and we start PhD now on this topic. Okay, for severe accidents, I have a few slides just to show you the phenomenology. So we distinguish 3 phases or 4 also if we add cooling. And the first phase is initiating. So it starts with fuel or cladding melting onset and then ends at hex scan wall melting. So it's, it determined by the codes we are using. In fact, like we use SAS family codes for initiating phase because SAS is working inside one assembly. Assemblies are independent. So I showed here the regions of melting and propagation axially and energetics in any severe accident depends on competition between negative and positive components. And negative component is Doppler and fuel relocation from the center to the periphery. And the positive component is cladding melting and relocation. So the task of the severe accident code is predict as good as possible these two mechanisms because they define the energetic, the reactivity, whether it's positive or negative, and power up and down. It's very challenging. Okay, SAS family is used. It was validated using CABRI and TREAT data. Then for transition phase, it's when hex scan, when the wall of the assembly is melted through, then it starts propagate radially. So it's illustrated here. It's now different situation. So there is radial propagation. Again, energetic now depends also on material stratification because in the molten pool, the heavy elements can go down, lighter can go up, and this now impacts also material stratification. But it also depends on the freezing at some areas and so on. So expansion phase, when we have recriticality moment. If we have secondary criticality, then we have mechanical impact, we have different mechanism of relocation, nuclear energy release, and so on. And now we are using as in previous phase, the code is Simmer family, which is also validated using Cabrian's Karabi data. And finally, as a final phase, we can say long-term in-vessel cooling, when the melt is relocated at the core catcher, and then we should analyze that it's not critical, then it is cooled properly, and so on. And here, probably, we need codes like CFD, I would say. Okay, it's another presentation of the same, what I said, which distinguish between early transition phase and main transition phase, and two routes for severe accident, which is more energetic route, shown with red, and less energetic route. Oh, yes, okay, I can skip because mainly I said everything about this. It's just more structured representation. And then in the final part of my lecture, I would like to show you a few examples of codes quickly, in particular Trace and Simmer. So, but first, this shows you the all codes, well, not all, but many codes used in Europe for liquid metal fast reactor modeling, for neutronics, CFD, deterministic neutronics, stochastic for subchannel codes, fuel-based radiation, severe accident, design-based accident, cold thermal hydraulics, and core thermal mechanics. Okay, that's just for reference. We collected what we know, the names. Then Trace, we are using at PSI. It's a legacy system code developed by NRC for light water reactor design basis accident analysis, mainly loss of coolant accident, but not only. It includes other coolants, in particular single phase sodium and lead, and it was modified at PSI for two-phase sodium flow using existing coding. The idea was that we take existing models for water, we go through and we carefully modify it, of course, equation of state, but also closure relations. So we didn't write new equations new conservation equations, but we modified closure relations. And it was validated using available test data. So here I showed the features of sodium boiler. Important parameters illustrated here, like interfacial area and drag coefficients and heat transfer coefficient. But I would like to probably emphasize several sodium boiling features. In particular, we have very high thermal conductivity and very low ratio of gas to liquid densities. And the boiling is characterized by quick formation of big bubbles, domination of annular flow regimes, and dry out mechanism of crisis. Okay, here I put the Trace equations. It's a six equation model. I mentioned already closure relations and they are emphasized here. So I just put some color at the places which were modified. So if you work, if you are interested on this development, then ask me, I will show you the PhD thesis devoted to this development. And this shows one of the validations we did for Trace, which is one of few available sodium boiling experiments done at KNS sodium loop in Karlsruhe in the 80s. So this is a diagram. So this is a test section with heaters. It was circulated by the pump, heat exchanger. Okay, and it simulated the loss of flow, so the reduction of flow rate and then start of boiling. Very well instrumented. So what we see here, so this is a flow rate, start of the boiling, and reduction of flow rate because we have generation of vapor, and at some moment vapor is block the flow area, and we have reduction of the flow rate to zero, and sudden increase of pressure. And we managed, it was very challenging exercise, but we managed to predict reasonably with two-dimensional model, both pressure shown in red, the predictions, and black is the experiment, and the flow rate evolution. So I have a few slides for CIMR, which I go quickly because I don't use CIMR myself, but from my colleague's presentation, I copied some nice pictures. So here I can say that there is a two-dimensional and three-dimensional versions. It's multi-velocity field, multi-phase, multi-component, Eulerian fluid dynamics code system coupled with structure model and with a space angle time and energy dependent neutron transport model, which is not diffusion. Yes, it's developed by consortium JIAEA, CEA, and KIT. Nodalization shown here in case of, it's either RZ in case of 2D version or XYZ in case of 3D. Neutronic domain is shown here. Yes, so heat and mass transfer models are very complicated because it includes, as you can see here, many components like molten fuel, solid particles, molten steel, mixed vapor, and finally the gas fuel, fuel in gas form, steel in gas, and so on. So it's really very complicated flow regimes, many components, many phases. And neutronics is also complicated, as you can imagine, because the configuration is changing. So now we have the fuel here, and next moment we don't have fuel here. So we need to be very flexible with preparation of cross-sections. And it is based on the microscopic cross-sections libraries, which contains Bondarenko factors, or sigma zero parametrization, which allows to simulate different mixtures, including fuel-free components, composition. It's performed, transport performed with SN, it's not diffusion, again, because in severe accidents, the transport effect can be very significant. And CIMR was extensively validated and verified for many applications. Okay, in summary, as I told you, I would like to give you three, I think, examples of knowledge gaps and encourage you to fill these gaps with new knowledge. So the first one is thermal mechanics of sodium fast reactor core and reactor structures. It's challenging because we need 3D modeling of thermal expansion of complex structures interacting with each other. We need core mechanics in normal operation, mainly wrapper tube deformation due to thermal expansion, but also swelling, radiative expansion, radiative-induced expansion. And we need 3D modeling of core mechanics in transient conditions, including very fast ones, for example, driven by pressure pulses. The second direction is SFR, thermohydraulic, and heat transfer in general, but here I mean 3D modeling of transition from forced convection to natural convection, what we see in Phoenix end of life natural convection test benchmark. We see uncertainties, modeling uncertainties, and also 3D modeling of heat transfer and fluid dynamics and decay heat removal systems like reactor pit, which also significantly three-dimensional, cooling of steam generator surfaces. We need CFD analysis here, and dynamic modeling of thermal electromagnetic pumps. Okay, electromagnetic pumps in general, and in particular thermal pumps. And the third direction, I would say, coupled neutronic, thermohydraulic, and thermomechanical also analysis of sodium boiling in low void SFR core. Okay, because we now have new phenomenology. What we had in SuperPhoenix in case of unprotected loss of flow, conventional reactor, the boiling resulted in quick and strong positive reactivity insertion and then quick, relatively quick, severe accident start. And then we go to CIMR, we care about relocation. But now with low void core, we see different phenomenology. We have significantly longer phases of sodium boiling without meltdown. And CIMR is not really was validated for such conditions. And we observed that we don't have enough experimental data. We don't have enough validated models. So it's important, in my opinion, direction for research. Okay, severe accident analysis in general, worth to invest also time and entry efforts because it's limited what we have in terms of modeling. We have SAS family, we have CIMR family, but as far as I know, we don't have anything new or anything else. All analysis is based on these two families of codes. I would also encourage you to go to this direction. So thank you for your attention.